continuing our study in James. We're in chapter 2 this morning. If you'd like to turn to the book of James, that would be great. We're going to be talking this morning about fulfilling the royal law. And some might ask, okay, what is the royal law? Even though we've read it literally in Scripture that way, oftentimes we kind of forget that James talks about the royal law. Well, many scholars insist that James is the oldest book in the New Testament. Its chronology explains why the so-called Jewishness of the book appears so obviously. And many times people see James as the New Testament version of the book of Proverbs in the Old Testament. So this is kind of the essence of Christianity. It's kind of like where the rubber meets the road in the book of James. The first part of chapter 2, we see his concern about partiality and favoritism gaining social traction in the Christian community, or the assembly, I believe is the word the King James uses, and the meetings is the way the NIV puts it. So after we explore the folly of favoritism, we're going to identify this royal law that James speaks about, and we're going to discover together God's instructions on loving your neighbor as yourself. Let's begin with prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. It's a beautiful day, Lord. No hurricane, no clouds in sight, no rainstorm. God, it's just lovely. But as we have come into this place, it's not because it's good weather and easy to get here. It's because we are here because of our love for you. And God, we ask for your anointing on your word today, that it would speak to our hearts, that we would acknowledge it, and Father, we would obey what James has written according to your word. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and all God's children say, amen. So we want to begin with verses 1 through 7 that deal with favoritism. Well, James begins by cautioning his readers about holding their faith with some form of personal advantage, as if they were privileged people just because they were Christians. And in one respect, we are privileged, but we are not privileged in such a way that we are above others. The term in our English Bible, favoritism, which is seen in the NIV, or the word respect for persons in the King James, simply means to give judgment with respect to outward circumstances. Judgment in respect to outward circumstances. So let's begin reading in James chapter 2 and verse 11. I was wanting to read the whole thing, but for time's sake, let's just focus on these first seven verses to begin with. Look what it says in James chapter 2. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism. Suppose a man, he gives an example here, suppose a man comes to your meeting or to your assembly wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing the fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand here or you sit on the floor at my feet, have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Or are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him in whom you belong? So as we look at this text, we see that James is talking about favoritism, showing favoritism from one person to another. Here someone comes in the door who is a doctor, a lawyer, or in some way very wealthy in the world, and we acknowledge, whoa, we're going to let him know, yes, come in, you are so welcome here. Sit down right here, we have this special place for you. And then someone else comes in rags who is not wealthy at all in the world's standards, and they are kind of not dressed real well, and we kind of look at them and say, hey, we're glad you're here, take this back seat. Sit over here on this side. You know, the Bible says we have had and express our evil thoughts in that way. Well, I want you to know that it's not only here in James, but in Romans chapter 2, verse 11, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 9, and in Colossians chapter 3, verse 25, they all state that God is no respecter of person. He doesn't show favoritism between one person and another. Now, I think this is really cool because that gives me a chance to get before God, doesn't it? That gives me, a lowly person, an opportunity just like the wealthy, rich person, because their status does not impress God, nor does my lowly position impress God. God looks at the heart. Can I hear an amen? God looks at the heart to see who we are. After this initial warning, James illustrates his points in verse 3 and 4. Look again. It says, if you show special attention to the man wearing the fine clothes and say to him, here's a good seat for you. You sit right up front. You're a person of position. So we want to give you a forefront position. And to the other man who is a nobody, maybe a stranger, nobody knows him, he just came in, and we say, well, just sit over here. We don't want you sitting up here with the other people. You know, this happens in churches, doesn't it? I mean, nod your head with me. You know it does. It happens in churches. But the Bible says that God is no respecter of a person, nor his stature, nor his finances, nor his fame. But literally, God looks at our hearts and he loves everyone who seeks him, seeks after him. And so we get a good example in James here, what we should not be doing. Well, the word meeting or assembly, depending on which version you have in verse 2, is a term from where we get the word synagogue. James is obviously speaking about the ecclesia, which is the Greek for the coming together of the church in an assembly. We are that group. We are that church. We are the body of Christ, and we come together for one purpose. It's not to be seen. It's not to take a fine front seat. It is simply to come together as the body of Christ. You see, someone said to me one time, and I remember this well, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. Amen. It doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, or what kind of clothes you wear, whether you drove up in a Mercedes or an old Ford rag truck like I used to have. When you come in, you're coming for the purpose, and God receives you that way. So the word meeting is talking about us coming together as the church. Life circumstances never determine the quality of one's faith in God. Now, I know that, and I've been in churches where you come in and they just greet you really well. For instance, when I was supply preaching some years ago, I was between churches, and it was a time we came back from Tallahassee, and we just said, we're available to preach, and so they would send us different places. I went to this one church, when we came in, they recognized the preacher, right? I mean, he got that preacher look, right? So it's coat and tie, Bible in hand, walking upright, with confidence, at least he looks that way. And he walks in, and people come up to him and greet him. Oh, you must be the speaker today, the visiting pastor. And they greet you, and they kind of flock around you and try to make you feel welcome. I think that's neat. Except I also noticed somebody else came in the back door and they just totally ignored them. They just kind of went by them and gave them a visitor card. That's wrong. You see, I am no more special, nor is any preacher any more special than any one of you. When we come into God's house, we're all on level ground at the foot of the cross, and we come before him with open hearts, and God reads that heart. He doesn't read your bio information. He reads your heart. Well, the readers here were in danger of dishonoring the Lord by dishonoring the poor. And James ends his treatment of favoritism with a bit of irony. Won't you look at verse 6 and 7? He says, it's not the rich. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you and hauling you into court? And yet when they come into church, you lift them up and give them a place of honor. But it's the same people that you're honoring and giving the best seat to the very ones who are calling you into court and suing you. Christians must consider God's royal law, and that's what we're going to look at today. So moving on from favoritism in these verses, James moves to identifying his royal law. He's clear as to what he understands the royal law to be. He writes in verse 8, if you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, look what he says, love your neighbor as yourself, then you're doing right. We've heard this before. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. He's quoting out of the Old Testament. But what he is saying is, James is saying that this is the royal law. Royal is an interesting word. We talk about it, and it really denotes kingly activity. In other words, this law is revealed by King Jesus. It's a law that's revealed by God in the Old Testament, carried forward into the New Testament. Love your neighbor as yourself. How many of us can honestly raise our hand and say we love all our neighbors just like ourselves? Well, I didn't raise my hand either. But, you know, that just means that we've got some work to do within our lives, don't we? We need to love all people the same. And that's hard to do in the flesh. In fact, I dare say, in the natural, it's impossible to do. We pick and choose all the time. But as Christians, we need to come to the point in our life, whether it's in a church house or it's outside, we need to come to the point when we look at a person and instead of judging them by their clothes, character, car, or home, we need to look at them and say, you know, God gave his life for that person. He died for that person. And, you know, some of those folks we got living in our neighborhoods, we think, well, he's just a mess and he's never going to know God and God's not going to save him. But, you know, God can. And you know, there's a light in your neighborhood. It's you. And you and I, in our own neighborhoods, are to be the light and the salt to the world. And we should be the ones who go to those people and befriend them for the purpose of getting them to know, getting them introduced to Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? You're awful quiet this morning. All right, thank you. I needed that kick in the seat. Praise God. So he's drawing, what James is doing is drawing an equivalent here. He's drawing a reference to Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. In Matthew, I want to jump back to the New Testament. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, Jesus summarizes the Old Testament code. Listen to what he says. This is Jesus. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Did he leave out anything? Love God first with all your being. God is first. But when you put God first, you will find that when this vertical relationship is like it should be, that this horizontal relationship with others becomes, let me use the word holy. It's different. It's separated from the world and the way they have relationships. So he says in verse 38, of Matthew 22, this is the first and greatest commandment. Love God. First and greatest. And the second is like it. If we love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, all our being, the second commandment is like it, that we should love one another the same way. We should love. The agape word in the Greek means to love sacrificially. To love somebody, let me tell you something. We were talking this morning in Bible study. We said, you know, we're supposed to do what's right even when it hurts, even when it costs us something. That's the way God's love is. It costs God something, that agape love. So when I love God that way, I sacrifice myself to him. But when I love my neighbor that way, it means that I'm willing to sacrifice something I have for them. In other words, it's not just about me. Does your neighbor have need of something? I was trying to drain a hot water tank the other day. And all as I've got is these hoses that pull out of these funny looking reels. And you can't disconnect them and use them for anything else. So I went across to our son's house and I looked. And I look at his house and he's got one of them goofy boxes with a hose all rolled up. And I said, I can't drain my hot water heater with that. So I went to my neighbor's house. And I spotted a hose in his front yard, but he wasn't home. And so I said, well, you know, I just don't want to take his hose. And he wouldn't mind, but I called him and I said, hey, can I borrow your hose? I'm trying to drain my hot water tank. He said, sure. He says, if you need more than one, there's one around back too. Get all you need. Do you understand what I'm saying? He was saying, it doesn't matter. Whatever I have, if you need it, you're welcome to it. Somebody called me the other day. Well, actually, Ray did. And Ray called me the other day, and he says, I have need of the trailer that you have at your house. I said, Ray, it's your trailer. Come get it. It used to park at his house. Actually, it's home now, but it's kind of still like Ray's trailer because I think he uses it more than I do. But he's welcome to it. In other words, when your neighbor needs something, we step up and we say, I have that. Would you like to take that and use it? Or in some cases, take that and keep it. So in Matthew's gospel, Jesus gives us these words, love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and your neighbor as yourself. What would you do for yourself? Well, I believe I would loan myself that garden hose out there. Amen. Well, if your neighbor needs it, loan it to him. Give it to him, whatever the case may be. The idea here is we're not really talking about garden hoses and trailers. We're talking about the attitude of my heart towards my brethren. That if they have need of it, I should let them have it. Let them use it. Okay? Without hesitation, I should say. Now, I know that I used to have a ladder in my garage, and every so often it would disappear. And I'd have some tools every so often, they would disappear. And so I love my brother. I love my son, too. And so I'd trek across the street, see if my son had my stuff. Amen? Because he didn't ask. He don't ask his parents. He just says, it's theirs, so it's mine. But that's really the way it should be. Now, obviously, if you're going to borrow something from someone, you ask them. And I have a Stan's rule here. This is not James. It's not Jesus. This is Stan. If you borrow something from somebody, listen closely. Why are you laughing? Don't just take it back, but take it back in at least as good a condition as what you borrowed it. And that's why our son, who lives across the street, doesn't want to borrow anything from me, because every time he borrows something of mine, he tears it up. Amen? And it breaks. I'm sorry. It breaks. And really, he didn't tear it up. It just breaks while he has it. And that was my fear of borrowing things from people, is that, you know, I got to be prepared to buy another one of these if it tears up while it's in my hand. So we need to do what's right with our brothers. Well, James's concern about how we treat other people is talking about those who are coming to the church. It becomes clear when we consider the issue through God's royal law. When we look at it through God's royal law and we think about people coming into our assembly, into the church, then we need to keep that royal law in mind. And that royal law says, treat your brother as yourself. Do for others the way you'd want them to do for you. Do it as if you're doing it for Jesus. Now, we had some particular people come into our church one time that a lot of Christians would shun. In fact, a lot of people in the world would shun, and they came into our church, and I was so proud of y'all. You just loved on them. You know, you hugged them, you shook their hands, you said you were glad they were here and all. And I don't know what their purpose of being here was, because they never came back. I don't know what their motive was, but I know what your motive was, and that was to love your neighbor as yourself. Doesn't matter what lifestyle they have, doesn't matter where they come from or what they look like. When they walk into the Lord's assembly, we are to treat them as if they are ourselves. We would treat ourselves. To love them the way Jesus loves them. And you know, that's the kind of thing that blows the mind of people in the world. They just don't get us. They don't understand us. But let me tell you what, we wouldn't understand either if it wasn't Christ in us. We would be the same. In fact, I dare say at one time, we were the same. So the royal law remains as applicable today as it did for Old Testament Israel. And one quality of the royal law, listen, unity. Unity. James offers a statement in verse 10 that communicates a unity of God's law by insisting that if one law is broken, what does the Bible say? If you've broken one, you've broken them all, right? And the Bible says, for whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. So James faced a unique situation here because first century Jews, they made a big distinction between what they called the significant laws and then those not so significant. So they didn't mind, I mean, they really focused on adhering to the Sabbath observance and by particularly and meticulously making sure that they observed the Sabbath according to Scripture. But then they just kind of disregard some of the other laws. They didn't pay any attention to them. For example, the law of the Sabbath observance was very important to them, while swearing an oath hardly even came on the radar. They didn't pay any attention to that at all. They swore oaths all the time. But before we judge them too harshly, let's consider how often we pick and choose what we're going to obey in Scripture and what we're just going to kind of, it's not like we disobey it, we just kind of don't pay any attention to it. Why are you smiling like that? You know we do that. But God says, my law is my law. You break one, you break them all. You're guilty. That's what the Bible says. So while Jesus did fulfill the law, it does not mean that we are relieved of our biblical responsibility to remain morally upright. We have a responsibility to God. Amen? Jesus fulfilled the law. We are not under condemnation of the law, nor do we have to adhere to the law. But here's the standard of the law of the Old Testament. When Jesus came, he raised the bar. He didn't lower it. He didn't say, you don't have to do this. He said, I've already fulfilled this, but I'm raising the bar. I'm bringing us to a higher standard of morality and living. Even so, as Jesus did this, our relationship to both God and his law is through faith in Christ. We're not under condemnation of the law, but we are under faith through Jesus Christ, not through keeping the law. Ephesians chapter 2 says this, is by grace you've been saved, through faith, not by works, through faith. And you know, so many religions, we're studying world religions on Sunday nights. I'm trying to think what night we're doing that. Sunday nights we're studying world religions. And every religion we look at, the false religions of the world, every one of them is based on behavior, what you do. But Christianity is based on a relationship, who you believe in. And I'm so thankful that my religion, my relationship with God, my position in the kingdom of God is not dependent on how I perform in this world. It's not whether I'm good or bad. That does not get me into the kingdom of God. What gets me there is my faith that I put in Jesus Christ for what he has done on the cross, his shed blood to cover my sins literally before Almighty God. So as we look at the unity of the royal law, we recognize that it is God, and he is so awesome in that he looks at me, but he looks through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Now, when I say it doesn't matter how I perform, I am not giving or suggesting that we have a license to do as we please. On the contrary, we have a responsibility as Christians because of what Jesus has done for us. We have a responsibility, but let me say this. I don't respond to God because of my responsibility. I respond to him because of love. It is love that motivates me to be who God called me to be. And when I fail, I confess that before God. He knows. I confess it before him, and I ask for forgiveness. He already knows, and he already forgave. But let me tell you something. I need to do that. I need to own up to my failures, my sin. And God is always faithful to forgive us. By the way, if I can't figure this out correctly time-wise, Jesus died 2,000 years ago and he forgave the sins of the world. Amen? And so that means when I come to Christ, he forgives me And all of my sin, past, present, and future in my life, was forgiven 2,000 years ago on the cross. Just thought I'd throw that in for you. Rather than transgressing any commandment, believers should speak and act, the Bible says. Look at verse 12. We should speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom. Not the law that brings condemnation, the Old Testament, but the law of Christ that brings freedom into our lives. So there is a law of liberty in verse 12 and 13. The words speak and act stress a continual act of commands. In other words, it's not speak once and act once. It's to speak and keep on speaking the truth and to act and to continually act out the truth that we know to be true from God. He calls us to continually speak and act and not just a one-time thing. Rather than being judged by the royal law, James repeats his earlier use of the word law to encourage believers to act and live as persons who are judged by the law of liberty. Such liberty in no way implies we do what we want, because we are commanded to be a holy people, one separated from the things and desires of the world and ourselves, really, to be separated from all of that evil and to be bound and in the presence and following after the ultimate rabbi, Jesus Christ, the teacher, the Son of God, who is deity. Such liberty in no way implies we do what we want. And I hear that so often. You Southern Baptists, because you believe that you're saved and you're always saved because that's what you believe. You believe once saved, always saved. Don't you hate that coining? You believe that, and so you think you can just live as you want. No, I do not. And let me tell you, the Bible doesn't say we can. The Bible says we are to come to Christ by faith, and through Him we receive the Holy Spirit, who guides and directs our lives. We are not to be doing what we want. We're to be doing what we're called to do by Christ. So he concludes that mercy triumphs over judgment. Undoubtedly, he recalled the words of Christ in Matthew 5, 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall be what? Shown mercy. While our nature is the big I and little you, and that's human nature, we should remember that it's all about Jesus. It's all about Him, and it's not about us at all. We're commanded to live our lives loving those who Christ gave His life for.